invite Scott Millican, Senior Warden of Trinity Fort Worth, to offer an important presentation on suicide prevention.
Good morning. A little bit nervous, but I'm more cold, so my voice shakes a little bit. I'm going to blame it on the cold. I'm Scott Millican. I'm the Senior Warden of Trinity. And what I want to talk about is suicide prevention and education. In 2011, my wife and I lost our daughter, Lauren, to suicide. She was 22. And in this decade, she is one of at least six known suicides suffered in our parish. And that is a combination of children, grandchildren, members, and former members. Statistically, and can we get we have the PowerPoint? Yep. And next one, please. So, how many people in faith communities are affected by suicide? It's actually one out of every two people. Next slide, please. And this is a combination. Where we get these numbers from is a combination of those who are currently considering suicide, B, those who are anxious that a family member or a friend might be considering suicide, those that have lost a loved one to suicide, and then those who have experienced suicidal thinking in the past but are no longer. So if you add all those up together, you get to basically one out of two. Just some other statistics that I want to give you. Over 47,000 suicides per year in the United States. It's the second leading cause of death from age 10 to 34. 69% of all suicides in the United States are white males. And interestingly, the U.S. rate of suicide over the last 5 years has been increasing, but the rate of suicide worldwide is declining and flat. And then last in that category, high-risk groups, and a lot of you have heard this before, military, active, and retired, and then LGBT communities are the highest risk groups within those subsets. This past May, I attended a workshop which is called the Soul Shop for Faith Communities along with Deacon Tracy. And this is a really great program that's designed to help minister to faith communities, to learn them, to help them learn how to better understand and deal with suicide and suicide attempts, and honestly, just general mental health issues within your faith community. There are at least 23 instances in the Bible of suicides or suicide attempts. So, I'm having a hard time reading that from a distance, and I'm gonna try and remember. I know Zimri, if everybody knows their stories. Zimri actually set his house on fire. Ahithophel hung himself. Judas hung himself. Saul and Abimelech fell on their swords. So these are obviously the most well-known ones. But an instance where, you know, probably I'd have to say one of the first known preventions was the jailer of Paul. If you recall in Acts, when the earthquake struck and Paul and his cohort were released, the jailer was in despair. He thought he had been at fault for that, and he was about to take his life, and Paul intervened. So there are many, many, many stories in the Bible of despair, and that's still a leading element when someone reaches that point in their life that suicide becomes an option. And most studies show that loss of hope and loss of social connections are the key elements that lead somebody to contemplate ending their life. So, how does this all involve us in our church life? As Episcopalians, we are called to go out and minister to the communities around us. But oftentimes, we forget to help those that are in our midst, our fellow parishioners. After our daughter's death, I became much more aware and in tune to the pain that others were carrying, and it really helped me empathize and to listen so much better than I had before. And I've learned that by simply reaching out and just having an honest conversation can help someone get better, or even in some cases, save a life. There are many myths surrounding suicide. One, that it is inevitable and it's not preventable, and that's false. Studies show that most people have reached the point where suicide is a viable option. They've been having an internal conversation with themselves about whether they should stay or whether they should take their life. So just by reaching out and asking someone a simple question, I've noticed that you seem to be struggling with something, or have you had thoughts of suicide, it gives that person the permission to talk about it. Suicide and mental illness are still, to this day, taboo and shameful subjects. And people are reluctant to share their details that they are hurting inside for fear of having a harsh judgment. So your honest and sincere approach to them will actually be a load off their soul, off their shoulders. Now, we're not the experts, and we don't have to fix anything or anyone. And once that person has been allowed to speak freely, you can help them form a plan to seek professional help. And this also kind of plays into the second myth, which by mentioning suicide to someone, that you are putting the thought in their head, and that's also false. They're already there at that point. One fact that is true that may not be as widely known is that when a family suffers a suicide loss, the chance of another family member attempting does increase. It's kind of called the legitimacy effect. Can we go to the next slide? And this gets into, so what can we do? We can, just a little love and a little skill and a network can help go a long way. But most of all, just responding to the call of God. Next slide, please. So, again, I'm having a hard time reading that from here, but you can see the quote from Isaiah 61 about the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord just helping us to just help the people who are hurting and binding them up. And next slide, please. So, the call, actually. So what are we called to do? The first one, the C, is for commit. So that means that we will commit to trying to have those difficult conversations. And they are difficult conversations. You need to challenge yourself to get out of your comfort zone if you perceive somebody or see somebody that's hurting that's in your midst. And that takes a lot of courage within yourself. So you have to commit to yourself and to God that you're willing to do that. The second thing is to ask. And not everyone will be able to speak about their commitment. What makes asking difficult? It's difficult to kind of want to get into that relationship with somebody. You know, again, we feel sometimes that we might be intruding on them. But again, as I mentioned earlier, just by starting that can really help get that person out of that area. And as soon as someone gives you an indication that they may be considering suicide, ask them in a way that's seen as compassionate. And can we go to the next slide, please? So listen. Be quick to listen, slow to speak. Invite them to tell their story. Tell me how suicide became an option for you or a solution. Tell me how suicide became a part of your thinking. And again, as I've said, listening is helpful all by itself. Next slide, please. And then to lead. Lead them safely, lead to safety, not to a solution, as I said. What you can promise them is discretion and a shared decision making. If it's possible, if you can remove the means by which you can safely, and then try and leave them in good hands. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we are not called to fix, but we can lead them to trained professionals. As lay people, this is what we're called to do. Next slide, please. So, what commitments? I will have that conversation. I will tell, I will ask. And in what context? With our family, friends, work, and faith community. At Trinity, we had a youth attempt suicide in August. Immediately afterwards, the clergy, our youth minister, and a few of the lay people gathered around the youth of the parish and parents together to have a frank and honest talk about suicide. And kids are smart, and they really look to adults to be honest with them. And I can tell you that the talk honestly did help. The individual did survive their attempt and has now changed schools, has been to an outpatient clinic, and is now taking medication and receiving therapy, and they're doing much better. So again, this just reinforces the fact that prevention is possible and recovery is possible. September was National Suicide Awareness Month, and my wife and I conducted a forum discussion on this subject with about 40 parishioners at Trinity. It was very, very well received. I learned about family suicides from people I've known at Trinity for years and had never heard of before. Plus, there was a woman visiting our parish who was suffering from bipolar disorder and really needed to hear our words. People are often in silent pain. They may have lost a job, a marriage, a familiar relationship that's caused them deep distress. And we need to recognize that pain before it really turns into despair. And again, it's just all about be willing to engage in that conversation and just show them your compassion and your humanity and your faith as well. So my challenge to you is to ponder and pray. What should our response be to this important subject? What are we called? What are we called to do in each one of our own faith communities? Thank you.
Walter Brueggemann says that the church should be a place where pain can come to speech. Thank you. Thank you very much, Scott.
Bishop, I just wanted to make a comment on Gail Smith from Trinity. But in the session where Scott and Pam and others met with our youth, what was probably one of the most sobering things to me is that there were youth present who had been considering suicide or had had that thought in the past. And I think it's just important for us to remember and realize that this is not something rare, that to be able to provide opportunities for people to have these discussions in a safe environment is really, I think, a responsibility for us as parishes.